Now we have a wonderful session with Sushila Ravindranath and Dayanita Singh. It is called The Book on the Wall.
How does one describe Dayanita Singh? She is a photo artist. She is also a bookmaker working with photography. Dayanita studied visual communication at NID Ahmedabad and photography at the Center of Photography in New York. And she has published 12 books. Her first book was on Zakir Hussain, which came out in 1986. Dayanita first met Zakir when she was 18. She fought and pushed through crowds to hear him play and then fell flat in trying to reach him. But reach him she did. And after covering his tours for 6 years, the book happened, the book was born. And also her love for music. For her, photography is also music. For her, photography is also literature. She believes in looking at forms, other forms, whatever one is engaging herself with. Myself, Mona Ahmed, is the history of her friendship with Mona Ahmed, a eunuch, her rise and fall. She's a friend. She wrote about her in her words. Dayanita has had solo exhibitions in the Art Institute of Chicago, the Hayward Gallery. She was part of the German pavilion in the Venice Biennale. Well, she's done all these extraordinary things all over the world. I just want to quote from Indrajit Hazra about her book, The File Room. I mean, it's quite evocative what he says. So file room itself is a file holding information of a giant specialized and dying storing cum, extracting technology that Dayanita, in the manner of miracles, has made flesh. But she's here going to talk about on the wall. I'm not going to tell you about it because she's going to really, it's going to be an extraordinary performance. Over to you, Dayanita, who's really one of our most exciting and important artists.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much, Sushi. I would like to start by felicitating the person who I think is the most important photographer in India, and I am so proud of the work he is doing now that I thought I wanted to, for once, publicly, privately I say this very often, but I just wanted to publicly once acknowledge P. Sainath and the great work that he's doing with the archive. You are the best. Yesterday when I was speaking with T.M. Krishna, I told you the story about how I came to Chennai and made a sort of fake book release for the File Room book so I could meet T.M. Krishna on an equal stage. And I didn't realize that a few months later I would be on the stage with him again talking about something that we love to talk about, or we found we love to talk about. What I didn't say yesterday was how things are just always a series of chance. Meeting Zakir, starting to photograph Zakir was a chance. If the organizer had not pushed me on stage and if I hadn't fallen on my backside in front of a hall full of people, I may not have waited for him. Likewise, if S. Gopalakrishnan had not sent me the email with T.M. Krishna's recording, I don't know how many years it would have taken for me to find T.M. Krishna. And so the book that I brought here to Chennai is called Museum of Chance. But with that book, I am trying something. I'm trying to make a proposition, and I'm willing to fall on my face or on my backside again for it, because I want to try and see if there is a place between the traditional book and the contemporary art world, between the book as the work, as I've always called my work, said that the book is at the heart of my work. The problem has always been, what do I do with the book? How do I explain to people that I actually feel much happier when I get my box of books from Steidl rather than when I walk into a gallery with my prints hanging on the wall. There is something about the print on the wall that has always made me feel that somehow the print was getting castrated behind the mat, behind the glass, in the frame, nailed to the wall, impossible to move around. And I, for a long time, always felt, what am I going to do with this disappointment? How do I carry on with photography, putting it on the wall? That's one part. The other part is, as I'm sure some of you may know, my mother was an obsessive album maker and made albums of all the photographs she took. So that's another part. For me, photography was about making books. It wasn't about making prints on the wall. And then I had this wonderful 3 years when I worked as a photojournalist in India. And I, because I worked for a foreign press agency, I was asked to photograph all the subjects that are extremely distressing, all the social issues, whether it was child prostitution, child labor. And at a certain point, I had to stop because I thought I was also, you know, I was just contributing to the problem. And, you know, all this idea that photography can change the world was just not right. Everything I'd been taught in school was not correct. And that's when I read Everybody Loves a Good Drought, and I started to see the photographs of P. Sainath. And for the first time, I saw photographs of the poor in India that left their dignity intact, that was not about slotting them as victims, which I think a lot of UNICEF kind of photography tended to do to sell photography, to sell poverty, to promote poverty in a way, if you like. I couldn't handle it, but I have great regard for P. Sainath, that he was able to build a form which talked about the most distressing issues in our country, and yet never ever did I find a photograph of his that in any way reduced the person. Nobody just stood like this in front of his camera. People really gave themselves to him, and so that's a long association that I have with P. Sainath as well. So for me, this is a dream come true. One day I'm on stage with T.M. Krishna, and the next day there's P. Sainath sitting in front of me. And you know, if I had to drop dead now, that would be fine. So I spoke about the photojournalist also because that really drew me to the essence, the most wonderful part of photography, which is the dissemination, which is something that gets lost in the art world. So if you did a cover story in those days for Illustrated Weekly, for example, you knew that 200,000 people had seen your photographs. You did something for the London Independent, and if you were on the cover in those days of the Independent, you could be sure that there would be at least seen by maybe 100,000 people again, but at least talked about by 5,000 people. Cut to 99, Art Gallery World, you're lucky if 300 people come to the gallery in the entire duration of the work. And then you start to feel, what is the point of this? Fortunately, in the middle of this time between photojournalism and the gallery world, I had met the great publisher, Walter Keller, and subsequently Gerhard Steidl. My colleagues often tell me I am who I am because of the men in my life. And actually, it's true. I am who I am because of my mother, a woman, Mona, my friend who's a eunuch, and all the men that I have listed so far, and more to come. I would love to one day make a book as a tribute to the men who made me who I am, rather than have my colleagues, I think you can understand the kind of double talk going on there. Well, so anyway, I had explored the idea, I had realized, I had tasted the magic of photography's dissemination. I had moved into the art gallery world, very, very attractive at first, still is, sort of, but the idea that these photographs were somehow were being held back by that gallery world. And the books started. I made, after Zakir, I made the book with Mona, then Privacy, and the books continued. But there were two separate worlds, and I was as though divided in half. There was the art world with the biennales and the museum shows, and there was the publishing world where I had to go to bookshops and say, please keep my book, because they would say, Thames and Hudson would say, make a book about Taj Mahal, you know, who's going to read a book about a eunuch, and things like that. That changed, but I still hadn't found a form where I could actually put the book on the table, so to say, and put it on your wall. And that center letter happened in 2007. And that happened because I had, since 2000, been traveling with, well, some wonderful men. And I wanted to write letters in response to them, to thank them for the incredible stories, discussions, conversations. Conversation is at the key, is key for me. And I thought, how am I going to write to so-and-so and say, dear so-and-so, you opened my eyes to such-and-such. So instead, I started to cut up my contact sheets and made these little diaries for them. I would make two copies. One would remain with me, one would be sent to them, with little prints pasted on them, which would be a diary of our time. In this case, those 5 days in Calcutta when Gerhard Steidl came to Calcutta with Gunter Grass. But they're not pictures of Gerhard Steidl necessarily. They are things we spoke about, the paper market, the bookbinding market we went to, the shops that we went to, some of the people that we met, etc., etc. And I gave this to Steidl when I met him, and he was absolutely thrilled to get this little object. And he said, what is this? And I said, oh, it's nothing. It's something I've been doing for many years, since 2000. I have 32 of these. He said, can we publish all 32? And I said, no, these are just diaries. They're little letters to friends. They won't make sense to anybody else. Anyway, he convinced me, and so we made this box, and we chose 7 of those books. He wanted to do all 32. It was impossible. It was too expensive. I was still making silver gelatine prints in those days. So we made this box, sent a letter. The box was made in India because I wanted it to be packed in, to be in this white cloth that I always associate with the packages that we get in the mail or used to get in the mail with the red stamp on them. So I insisted I wanted that fabric. I wanted this kind of printing. Boxes made in India. Empty boxes go to Germany. They get filled with the 7 books. And then they travel around the world. This box was sold for 60 euros. It wasn't made into a limited edition. It was a mass-produced book, full edition of 3,000 books, all sold out, last I checked, on Amazon for 10,000 rupees. So I thought, that's very interesting. Something new has happened with this box. People want to have the idea of an exhibition that doesn't cost a ton of money, that doesn't cost a lot to insure and ship, nothing in fact. And even if a book gets damaged or stolen, as is often the case, you buy another box while it was available. So that was sent a letter. One of the ways that I felt I had managed to bridge the gap that of the two worlds that was so distressing to, well, not distressing, but made me uncomfortable. And then there was this wonderful project that Hans Ulrich and Agnes B. and Christian Bultanski had started. And I wonder if someday we at Paris might have resources to also do things in the print media. So this, what they did was, they print 200,000 copies of this, they invite an artist, and you can do what you like on the pages. You can write, you can leave them blank, you know, it's a contemporary artwork. And so I thought, this was the time I was really struggling to tell people, do not go to photography school, please study literature, bring some experience into your life, study form in literature, and then come to photography. But I felt nobody was paying attention, so I thought, I'm going to take this project and make it into my reading list. So if you want to be an artist, I thought these were very important books for you to read. Difficult Loves by Calvino. Yesterday I said I come from the Calvino School of Form and the Zakir Hussain Academy of Focus. That was not tongue-in-cheek, I meant it very seriously. Calvino always finds a new form for each subject matter. Jeff Dyer, I think, is a contemporary version of him. That's Difficult Loves, Shadow Lines, Running in the Family, the most brilliant book if you want to understand editing, which is, in a way, all that photography really is now. A Room of One's Own, of course, of course. Jeff in Venice, Death in Varanasi, Jeff Dyer. Now I would list some other books of his. All You Who Sleep Tonight, a book that I often carry and carry with me when I travel. Austerlitz, the book that I give to young aspiring photographers. I give it to them to read. It's my favorite photography book for the way Sebald uses photography in his book. And I say, read this book and come back to me. So far, nobody has come back, which is fine. And of course, The Idea of India, Sunil Khilnani, fiction, exquisite literature. So, Sent a Letter had happened, and I can't pronounce the name, Point d'Ironie, French name, something like that. But so this got disseminated all over the world. I myself distributed it with Hans Ulrich in Delhi during the art fair. And at Jaipur, I took this to some people and they said, no, 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 please, please, no more menus. They thought I was giving them a Domino's handout. But that was nice too. I liked doing that at my exhibitions. In Kochi Biennale, I was handing out my postcards and lots of people said, no, please, please, we don't want any more. No, 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 please. And I said, no, please, it's free. And I learned how to say that in Malayalam, which I can't do right now. But people somehow were not used to the idea of a gift just arriving. They thought there must be something to it. So this brings me to the book that I just handed to Sainath, File Room, which is the first time I had the beginning of an idea. Sainath, can I borrow it back? Like a true Indian gift. So I said to my publisher, Gerhard Steidel, is it possible that we can make a book that doesn't have my name or your name or even the title on the cover? He said, that's not possible. That's ridiculous. Nobody makes a book without a name on the cover. I said, since when did we do something that everybody does, Gerhard? Then typically, angry with me, comes back the next morning, yes, Singh, you were right, we can do it. And then I said, by the way, Gerhard, is it essential that every book must have the same cover color? He said, yes, how else are you going to make an identity? I said, the identity is formed by the picture, so let me try different colors. I wasn't quite sure why I did that. And again, he said no. Again, he said okay the next day. Then when these books arrived in India, I thought, why do I want to have the same cover? Because if I can keep changing the covers, and my crafty side, I had made the inside image the same size as the front cover. So I cut up some of my books, pasted them in front, placed them on the wall, and then Kyoto Museum of Modern Art says they want to show my work. And I said, you know, unfortunately, all the prints are out. It's very expensive. You know, insurance will be a big problem. I'm too busy. Why don't you buy 72 of my books from Steidel? I'm authorizing you to cut up two of them and display that on your walls. Silence. And a week later, they said, it sounds like a good idea. Can you give us a precedence of where this has been done before? I said, I wouldn't be doing it if it had been done before. I'm trying to do something new. So they showed it, and then the Tokyo Museum of Modern Art took it, and now it's showing at the Queen's Museum in this big India show, and it works really well when I just say, I'm sorry, but the only work that I have is this File Room book. So that's what happened with File Room, and I thought, now I've really cracked it. Now I've found a way that I can make an exhibition out of the book, not just in a miniature form, but almost as big as my prints used to be, my silver prints. For those of you interested in technicalities, the big shift in my life has been when I stopped making silver gelatine prints, because those silver gelatine prints now, the paper, I used to use a Hungarian paper called Forte, that went out of production, and the silver gelatine paper now doesn't have the same quality, doesn't have the same amount of silver in it. So I started to make digital prints, with a lot of apprehension. And what that meant was, I still shoot on film, I scan my negatives, and I take them to the lab in Delhi, and we make digital prints. It's the same scans, that are going to Steidl and he's making a book. And I said, why is it that the print, the inkjet print, gets so much value, is so appreciated, and the offset print made from the same scan is treated like a poor cousin? Whereas in my case, it's really at the heart of the work. And by then, I had worked out what I thought was my small, I won't try and qualify it. I had worked out a system where the book could be in this wooden structure, and that would go onto the wall, looking exactly like one of my framed prints. In fact, it's exactly the same size as my silver gelatine prints used to be. And it's still a book. So by this time, Gerhard Steidl had been convinced of the idea. Oh, and I forgot to tell you, with file room and having all these different colors, covers, when I was representing Germany in the Venice Biennale, again, the same discussion, can I put my book? No, a book is not a work of art. This is a contemporary art space. How can you bring your books in? You can sell them outside. I said, I will sell them outside, but I want them on the wall. No, 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 all that. Finally, lo and behold, there is a blank wall. And the curator comes to me 2 weeks before the opening in Venice and says, you know, what are we going to do with this wall? Should we put some textile? What would you like? I said, well, you know, Steidl is just here in Germany. He could send us some books and we could have those on the wall. And that's what happened in the Venice Biennale, in this mecca of the art world. This file room book, the book of archives in all these different colors, was displayed. So that sort of got me this official sanction, if you like, the idea of the book being in the contemporary art space. And then this structure came up. And then, by this time, Steidl knew the plan. So now, I didn't need to cut up my books. I asked Steidl, is it not possible that every image inside the book is also on the cover? He said, oh, that's ridiculous, Dianita. Every time you come back with more and more absurd suggestions. I said, but think about it. What is the problem? And he said, well, it has to be printed on different paper. I said, it's okay. Print it on different paper. But give me quality that matches silver, because I want to be able to say that this is as worthy of being on display as a silver print. If you like my work, then you must love this too. Why do you want just the silver and not this? And then I took the structure to show him, and I said, and when I'm giving it to you in this structure, so you have the possibility to put it on your wall, and you have the possibility to turn it around and have the back image on display. So you can keep changing the image. So here's an artwork that you can keep playing with, that is not static, that is not hidden behind glass. And it's very much a book. You pull it out, you read it, there's a beautiful text by Avik Sen. It actually goes through 30 years of my photography, so in a sense, you could call it a retrospective if that's the kind of thing that gives it more value. Here's Zakir Hussain, here's Adam Fuss, just various chance encounters of my life. I think chance is the key word, and that's why I made Museum of Chance, but also because I do make mobile museums now. But those are made with print, and this is my Museum of Chance book. And then I thought, okay, now I've got the book on the wall. I want to do more, because of course I can never be satisfied. It's never good enough. I'm never good enough. I always have to do something more. And that's what I thought I would present here before I present it next week in Delhi and before I present it at the art fair as a limited edition artwork. I had tested this out last year, but now I'm convinced that this is going to become my work, that it is, you know, if painting is art and sculpture is art, why can't my book be my art form? Why is it only art when it's a print on the wall? So, and the box is very much part of it. Many years have gone into the getting the box right. So it's not to be put on the ground, it's very much part of the work. And so now the single print on the wall can be put aside. And this now is my exhibition. And then, when you are tired, as is possible, then you say, or you want to change the conversation in the room, you put Nargis in front. And then you say, now that I've got Nargis in front, let's put Fellini's wife in front. And then let's see how that changes the conversation. And I thought, this is what I was missing. You know, when I worked for the Illustrated Weekly, or I would sometimes find that when you eat omelets on the road, you find a paper bag made out of your own photographs. And that's very good because it tells you exactly the value of your work in case your head was getting too inflated. And I thought, I sort of like that. I like that people engage with photography when it's in the print media. Like this, you know, we gave this out in the winter in Delhi, and a lot of people used it to sleep that night on the street on Lodhi Road because it was cold. And that's what it was more important than to frame this somewhere in the wherever they wanted to take it. It was more useful to sleep on that night. So with this form, I thought now, or I think, and I'm willing to be booed down for it, it's fine. Something else will come out of that. I thought I found a form which will engage the viewer, the reader, in having the work, in enjoying the work, in experiencing it, and in changing it. So that's what I did, or that's what I'm going to do now. So this is going to become the work. So the next time you come to an exhibition, there will be, I'm now making the suitcases, so there will be 5 suitcases, and that's how I'm going to travel, and this is going to be... So, this could be a work, no? It doesn't have to be a painting on the wall to be considered contemporary art. And I hope I don't get... Well, I hope the audience is half as receptive as you have been in Delhi. We'll see in the art fair. And I was so happy when the Litfest invited me and were open enough to let me have a session on the book on the wall, because they could have just said, you know, don't be absurd, what are you talking about? And so I get a chance to present my work as it will be from now, offset, because I love the quality of offset that Steidl offers me. I happen to like that quality more than I like silver gelatin, more than I like digital. So this is how you're going to see my work. And this is what I decided to do with the book. So this is the book that's available. So did I explain that this book now has 88 different covers? No. Oh, sorry, I'm trying to tell you too many things. So there are 88 images in the book. And then I went to Steidl and I said, can it have 88 different covers? And he said, yes, okay, reluctantly. And now what I have is, you can order 88 books of mine and you have an entire show. However, I know that Amazon and all is very useful in getting books, but I like bookshops, I like paper, I like the smell, the conversation, all of that. And I thought, I have to fix this situation, at least for myself. So the deal is, I am the only one who has the sets, the full sets of the Museum of Chance book. So if you get fixated on the Nargis cover, for example, you can't write to Amazon for it, because Amazon will give you any cover that they have. So you can keep writing to Amazon and you'll get different covers, or you might get the same cover again and again, I don't know. But you can't get the cover of your choice. You go to a bookshop, if they have 5 of my books, you can choose. If they have 10, you can choose. But if you come to a book exhibition of mine, to an event of mine, then yes, you can choose from my limited edition of 352 books, you can choose your cover. So what happened in Bombay was, that A, people came in. I didn't have these objects at that time. I just had these structures on the wall. And people said, she's lost it or what? She's pasting her prints on different colored cloth. You know, she's a black and white photographer. Then gradually they start to see the spine. Somebody gets it, somebody doesn't get it. It actually doesn't matter because I have an idea of where I want to push the book to. But then people wanted to buy the edition. And then they said, oh, I'd like the girl, Natasha. And I, you know, maybe Natasha was already gone from that set. Then they had to choose something else. And I said, well, look at the back as well. And then they would turn the book around and they would say, oh, but I want the Nargis cover at the back. So what was happening was people got it and they started to buy two, three, and some young kids. This was all young people. It was none of the older collectors. It was not the traditional art audience. It was young architects, young designers, buying the book to hang on their wall as a work of mine. And now, I think I'm in a situation to say, this is it, really. I love offset. I love the idea of the book. I want it to be on the wall as well. I want it to be a book as well. So what happens in the exhibition is very interesting because the book becomes the catalog of the exhibition. So it's a book, it's an exhibition, and it's a catalog, and it's my print. That's it, really. So that's this part of the presentation. And we have a little more time? I didn't see any cards as yet. Because I have part two. Yeah. Just to clarify, because yesterday I had some people come and tell me how they thought I was undermining photography and giving more importance. How many people in this audience are photographers?
Meaning anybody who clicks.
How many people here have mobile phones? So, and all those mobile phones mostly now have cameras, and at a certain point you start to make pictures. So I just want to leave you with another thought, which is that photography as we knew it is over, which was about getting someplace, having the right equipment, getting the right exposure. Now, everyone who has the luxury of having a mobile phone has not only a still camera, but a video camera. This is a great, great moment for photography because now you could say photography starts. Now we're going to see different gharanas emerge in photography. We had a certain kind of photography before, but now when a botanist is going to photograph, he's going to take very different kind of images than a photographer, than someone who's trying to make a good photograph. When a mathematician photographs, we have to see what he does. We have to see what a historian photographs. So we are going to have wonderful new kinds of photography. I already see it a lot. I joined Instagram for that reason, to see what people were putting out. There are wonderful photographs coming out. So where does that leave photography? And that's where you need to come back to literature. That's where you need to come back to cinema and to classical music, to understand editing, to understand building the narrative, to understand sequencing, and then, most importantly, finding the form. What is the new form going to be for photography when you can print on almost anything? And I'm sure the next iPhone will have a projector built into it. So then I could be standing here and doing two projections at the same time. I don't need to bother with all the people at the back. Or if nobody invited me here, I could be outside and projecting on the wall as well. So everything's going to change in the idea of what a photographer does, who a photographer is, and I think it's fantastic because now photography is really just the tool. It's the alphabet that we collect, and let's see what kind of poetry emerges from it, what kind of prose emerges from it, and what form that is going to take. It doesn't have to be a print on the wall. So I found a form for myself. I would encourage you that while you make all the images, to think about backups, to think about the archive. Otherwise, we're going to have a problem with biography and that we were talking about in the earlier session. So we need backups, and we need to think about the form. If we want to put this imagery out, if we want to call ourselves photographers, just making a photograph is not enough. You are going to have to think about what is the form that you want to put it out in. That's the end of part two. To my favorite photographer.
Hello. Hello. I'm here.
Hi.
I think this has been an extraordinary post-lunch session. I even overcome my sambar and curd rice sleep. That's really superb. In my humble view, not only the way you presented, but the story that unfolded. I hope you have written a book about that, because I thought this is not just about a story of choice. This is a story of change making. It is the way you are thinking, and every one of us who are in this business of change need to take lessons from that. You challenge just about everything. Thank you so much. Most humble.
But that's what being an artist is, no? It's no big deal.
Hello, ma'am. I have a question.
Where are the photographers' questions? That's what I'm waiting for.
Ma'am, you're talking about photojournalism.
Yeah.
I happened to read Susan Sontag.
Right.
And view on photojournalism, where she calls photography as a voyeuristic behavior.
True.
As in, where she says, like, looking at a photography, people do not understand how the photo came into being. But if a photo does not talk about how the photo came into being, then the very purpose of photography is defeated. But the moment when you try to talk about literature and the form of creating photojournalism, a photo literature to an extent, were you trying to consciously defend photography?
Defend?
Yes, because I'm very sure you have been exposed to this idea of voyeurism that comes from looking at a photograph.
See, first of all, I'd like to, if I may, I'm a great Susan Sontag fan, so don't get me wrong. But I think there was a time when we needed On Photography, when we needed Roland Barthes, when we needed Walter Benjamin. We still need them, but there is a lot more. And to all of you who are going to quote Susan Sontag, I would suggest you read Jeff Dyer, Ongoing Moment. You see, there was Cartier-Bresson's Decisive Moment. I'm more of the Ongoing Moment school. And that Ongoing Moment is full of contradictions. It's a much larger sweep and is, I think, a much more engaging form. I didn't completely understand your question because I sort of wanted to put across, I forgot to say in part two, the idea about Susan Sontag, not to say that that's not important, but my reading of photography now is actually Calvino. If you read Difficult Loves and read the adventures of a photographer in that, you get the essence of much more than voyeurism. You get really the fiction of photography, the lie of photography.
Hello, I have a question, madam. I'm Karthik, I'm a photographer. I'm seriously fond of literature, and especially Tamil literature. What I was thinking is, you have shown those books names and all,
yeah,
which was all of different languages but got translated in English. But most of the Tamil literature, most of the Tamil poems have not been translated into many, especially in English languages.
But I forgot to put Ramanujan here. That is a mistake.
That was most of Sangam literature only.
Yeah.
But what I was saying is, the contemporary Tamil literature,
yeah,
contemporary Tamil poems, which I am reading, I want to translate them into photographs. The thing is, how to take this out of Tamil Nadu, like the Tamil.
But wait, my dear. Please don't even attempt to try and...
No,
illustrate,
like,
a photograph, a poem. Don't go that route.
Okay.
Please don't think that I was talking about literature as photographers now illustrating literature. I was talking about literature because it gives a certain life experience. Mm. It gives a certain experience that otherwise might take me 50 years, right? Which is one part. Mm. The other part is the form. So if you look at, say, how Calvino found a new form for each book of his, that to me is something to study. Yes. So it's wonderful that you're interested in Tamil poetry. And I wonder if you could find a way of writing, of photographing around or beside the poem, rather than trying to become
actually,
the poem.
Maybe the question should have been molded in a way which you had said now.
Okay.
Yeah, that's it.
Hello. I have a question. Actually, I got into photography a few years ago. Can you see me? I'm
here. Yeah. Hi.
Hi. You do a lot of black and white photography, and I'm interested in black and white photography. But a lot of people say, you know, photography on film is dying. And even here, I use a Neopan, and a lot of people have been complaining about how Fujifilm wants to kill the Neopan, and you know. And here, I try to get some photographs printed, but most labs are, you know, closed down, and everyone's moving to digital. What do you feel about this what people herald as the end of film photography?
Well, it's very sad for me, so I just try and stock up on as much film as I can. I only use Tri-X, Kodak, Tri-X, 400 ASA all my life. So it's very difficult for me to even now go to Fuji, which I don't like, or to Ilford. So I know that a time will come when I will have to switch to digital. What I don't like about digital is those you know, the big bulky cameras and somehow the aggressiveness of them. And if I have to use a big bulky camera, I would much rather use my Hasselblad, using my belly as a tripod. So I have been waiting for the perfect small camera to come for me to switch to digital. I think I would still shoot in black and white. Leica has made a black and white camera where the sensor doesn't record color. It just records illumination. And so you can get a black and white, pure black and white photo. So that's one way. But the other way, I'm a perfect bag lady because I have things to pull out, is this camera. This is the Lumix Panasonic. It is the smart camera. It's not a smartphone. This is what I was waiting for. Because this has a sensor which is almost two-thirds of a full-frame sensor. I can shoot shutter priority, aperture priority, full manual. I can choose my... It's a dream for me. I can choose my ISO. I don't have to. I think the problem with all the phone cameras is that everyone's pictures look the same because there's, unless you put filters, you know, it's all pretty much the same technology. So you can't really play with the light. And what fun is photography if you can't really, you know, control and master the light? So this camera is going to do that. And this just came out last month. So by the end of the year, we'll have a completely different conversation on digital photography. So it's happening. I think they're understanding that there are people who want something else from digital photography. So Apple and Leica seem to be in talks. I hope that's not just a rumor, but can you imagine what that iPhone will be with a Leica collaboration?
Hi, I have two questions for you to answer. The first one is, it's brilliant how you've taken photography and taken it beyond being just a visual experience into a fairly kinesthetic experience. Can you share some of your other ideas to play with the way you present your photography, which have been shot down, or maybe ideas that your contemporaries have had, which you thought were brilliant? That's my first question. And the second question is that you mentioned Instagram and how every one of us can now be a photographer. But that again is a dilemma because there's earlier it was easy to discern and appreciate good photography and good photographers because it was a rarity. The medium itself was extremely uncommon. But now with everyone shooting photographs and everyone posting it on social media and Instagram, the first thing is it's very difficult to find genuine photographs and genuine photographers who might have a very different approach to photography. And at the same time, there's a lot of mediocrity that you're exposed to because everyone is a photographer. So those are my two questions.
Okay, the first one I've forgotten. The second one, let's say everyone in this room can now speak Tamil. Suddenly I wave a wand and everyone's speaking Tamil. That doesn't make everyone a writer, because everyone may not even want to become a writer. Everyone may not want to become a poet. Everyone may not want to become a non-fiction writer. Some will take it on and do something more with it. But I think what I would say to you is that everyone is making photographs. At some point, everyone is going to have what we call a good photograph. I'm not so interested anymore in the idea of the good photograph. I think a photograph gets imbued with your intention. So that is why the work of P. Sainath is not like any other photographer who will work with challenges in society, because he's not just coming in as a photographer. He's a very good example of what I think will happen now to photography, because people's intention to take those pictures will be very different. When a granddaughter is photographing her grandmother or vice versa, it's a different kind of picture than when I would take that photograph as a photographer trying to take a good photograph. So I think it's just a start. In a sense, you could say photography begins now. Now that it's truly democratic and it's truly the universal language. Now we'll see what forms emerge, you know. I'm just saying poetry, prose, because those are the forms we know from literature. Who knows what's going to happen when everyone's projecting on each other's t-shirts as you're standing in the queue for the bus, for example. That could be another idea, no?
I think we've run out of time.
Already?
Maybe one last question.
Last question.
I have a question. Hello? Here. Here, ma'am.
Paragraph, just one short question.
Yes. Every artist has wants to convey a theme through their art. There's a means, they use art as a means to convey something.
Who told you that?
I mean,
did they tell you that in art school?
No.
Okay.
I mean, what do you want to convey through your art? That is my question.
Nothing. I try to make my photographs as open-ended so that you will make what you want out of it. I don't want to, I'm not a magazine photographer where Mr. Jacob asks me to tell you the full story of the situation. I, in fact, if anything, want to keep the story out, and I want you to bring your story and make something out of it.
That's nice, ma'am.